Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship today. Had a little bit of microphone issue, though, so I might be on this one the rest of the time. But we welcome you to worship. We're so happy to have you here today. And it's a special day because we have our youth going to be doing our service here in a little bit. But before that, I do have some announcements, of course, to make. So first of all, after this service, because we only have one, we will have a congregational meeting. We need to have a vote for all members, if you could stay, to vote on whether we want to bring Aaron Michaud to be our youth and young adult pastor. So that'll be directly after. And then we still have some sign-up opportunities for various things in the social hall, including van drivers. We need two more sets of drivers to bring kids home in the next few weeks. So if you'd like to go get some really tired kiddos from camp and bring them back, go ahead and sign up for that. The women's Bible study for the next couple of weeks will be meeting in the new fireside room, not in the social hall. And that's because Cap will be here practicing the Wizard of Oz for the next 2 weeks, and the social hall will be in use. And then finally today, there is no children's time. We made that decision because I really feel it's important for our children to hear what our youth have been up to see what they could be doing here in a few years themselves, and to just learn about how we can serve our fellow man. There are the word searches, though, if the kids need those. If you have a kiddo that needs that, they're back on the podium. But are we ready to worship? Are you guys awake out there? Okay, let's worship.
Good morning, Wyatt Park. Go ahead and stand with us. I'm Ann, if I haven't met you yet. I'm covering, filling in with Mark this month, and so we're going to start some worship together. So.
You. morning, everyone. Go ahead and have a seat. Our scripture today comes from Matthew chapter 25, verses 34 through 40. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat, and I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" And the king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of these, the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me."
Now if you'll bow your head and join in prayer with me. Wonderful Father, we are so incredibly blessed every single week that we get to have just this little oasis, this little moment where we get to just be intent on worshiping you, and we get to have this idea of everything that you've done for us. You are a God who loves his people so much that you carry us through whatever life may bring. You are the type of God that leaps chasms, and we are so grateful for that. Grateful for the love that you willingly give us every single day for the mountains you move. Thank you for everything that you have carried us through, whether it be the troubles of the past day or week or month. And thank you for the fact that you will do that tomorrow as well. It is in your most precious name that we pray. Amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
lead me, guide me. Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, we are just surrounded by your love, by your mercy, and by your grace, a grace and mercy and love we don't deserve, but are so thankful for. And Lord, we know that throughout this world, there are so many hurting individuals, so many within our country right now that are grieving, that need you. And so we lift them up to you, Lord. Lord, we know that there are many in our congregation that are weary. And so we give that over to you. And we are excited today, Lord, because we have our youth with us to share about how they got to be your hands and feet. So we praise you in that moment. We thank you, Lord. Pastor Cindy is here with us. We are thankful for her healing, and we continue to lift her up to you as well, and all that need your healing, Lord. Lord, you are an awesome, mighty, wonderful God. And we are humbled by your presence. And Lord, Lord, we need you each and every day. We need you to guide us, to deliver us from all the evils of this world. And Lord, as we finish our prayer today, I want to do so with the prayer that you taught us, with the Lord's Prayer, using debts and debtors. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You know, as we come to this table today, I just want to take a minute and I want to stop. First of all, to try to light this candle. I knew this wasn't going to go well. This is when you practice and practice and practice and then it doesn't still. You know what? And I just want to think about what Jesus might have been feeling as he came to the table with his disciples. He knew exactly what was going to be coming. He knew the pain, the suffering, and he tried so hard to make them understand it all. He knew that soon he would go from the table to the cross and make that ultimate sacrifice, not just for his disciples, but for all of us. And that weight must have been heavy on him. It must have weighed on his mind about what he was getting ready to do. And yet he still continued to serve in the very most basic way. He continued to love. He continued to care for his disciples. And he did so by washing their feet. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever had your feet washed by someone, but it's a very humbling experience. Feet washing today is nothing like what feet washing would have been like when Jesus was alive, because his disciples didn't wear shoes. They traveled with sandals, with grimy feet. They were dusty from all of that, and they didn't shower on a regular basis. No, Jesus would have been washing away layers upon layers of dust, just as he washed away the layers upon layers of sin when he went to that cross. And as he washed their feet, he left them with something from the book of John that I want to share with you. He said, "I have set an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than the master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed to do them." Jesus was showing them how to serve, how to love, and how to care for one another. Will you join me in prayer? Oh, Heavenly Father, help us to have eyes that see others as you see them, to love like you love everyone, and to serve as you have served. We need to invite others to this table, just like you welcome all of us each week. And as we come, let us not forget what this table truly represents and the sacrifices that were made for us, that ultimate sacrifice, so that we might have life everlasting. Amen. So on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus had gathered in the upper room with his disciples, and they were celebrating the Passover. And this would have been the last time that he was with all of his disciples in that capacity. And he took the bread, and he gave thanks for it. And he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, and he gave thanks for it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." We know that when we come to this table, we are doing so with our brothers and sisters around the world and through the ages as we proclaim what we believe. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Come to the table and partake.
Amazing grace.
message today. Give us just a minute as we get them all situated. And I'm going to hand over this mic. Which one of the youth has taken the mic first? Probably Brayden. Okay, we'll start up Brayden.
I'm Brayden.
I'm Drake.
I'm Ella.
I'm Lily.
I'm Della.
I'm Jackson.
I'm Emily.
I'm Liv.
I'm Cameron.
And first, before we begin, we just want to thank you all for being our support, nurturing, loving us, and sending us out into the mission field, because we represented White Park, and without your love and support, we couldn't have done that, and I think we rocked it. We did well. So, yeah. All right. So the first question is, describe Benton Harbor. What did you see? Who did you meet there? How were the people struggling? Tell me about the community.
For me, Benton Harbor, it was a struggling place, but it was also a place of hope. It seemed like there was some bad parts about it, and people knew that. But the hope came. There was people that are willing to try to change what's happening there and make it better and help its future. And we were able to be a small part of that. And then there were some great characters that we got to meet. We were split off into two groups, so I'll let the people that are in the other group speak on their people. But we had, his nickname was Red. I forget his real name, but he was helping make a garden. He's one of the great characters that I got to meet. Anyone else?
Our leader for our group, his name is Emma. She was in charge of a garden for the community that she hands out vegetables and stuff that she grows for free. She was amazing, very nice lady, really cared about the community, did a whole lot with the city hall there, I guess, with iron in the water, and got that fixed, and lead in the water, sorry. Been at their tails for 3 years until they actually fixed it. So yeah, Miss Emma was a doll. She was amazing. We loved her. So.
All right. Harbor, Michigan is where we went, in case you didn't get that. And so it is a little neighboring town to St. Joseph, Michigan, which was kind of fun for us because, coming from St. Joseph, Missouri, we had a little tie. And they are the twin cities, but they are totally opposite. Does anybody want to speak to that?
St. Joseph was very, wealthy. They had a lot more than Benton Harbor. Benton Harbor was mostly black people. They were 90% and or 95, something like that. And they were not as wealthy as St. Joseph St. Joseph. And
So the poverty rate, the average salary in Benton Harbor was $27,000 a year. And in St. Joseph, the average salary was $52,000. So that just gives you a little perspective, the night and day difference just by crossing the river. So what was the most meaningful work that you did on mission trip, and why?
For me, it was working with Ashley and Red. They're a father-daughter duo, and we helped them with their garden that they were making at the time. They were just, Red's been a part of that community for forever now, And he's been impactful in that community since the 80s and 90s and 70s. And he's just been doing, I don't know why it started with 80s and 90s and then it was 70s, but no, they've just been super impactful on that community. And without them, it would be a lot worse than what it is. And we were able to help out with that.
The most meaningful thing to me was we went to this place called the Harbor House, which was like, it's kind of like a daycare, I'd say, for like people with disabilities, older people with disabilities, dementia, and just like, I don't know, struggling, I guess. And we went there and we would just like hang out with them all day. We'd do workouts and just crafts and just hang out and do whatever they wanted to. And those people were so excited when we all got there, and I could tell that we were excited too. We went there twice, my group did, and it was so fun. And just to meet all the people and hear like their stories and just hear about them was like really just a crazy thing, and it was just really cool to meet all of them, and I thought it was pretty cool. Yeah, I said that already, but.
I got to work on Miss Emma's garden. And she would give out free vegetables to anyone who needs them, so they could come and pick their own vegetables, and yeah.
The most meaningful thing to me was definitely getting to work with Miss Emma. She is one of the most amazing people I've ever met. She's been through a lot of hard things in her life, but she's still powering through. She has a bunch of different gardens around Benton Harbor. And so basically we just fixed it up and helped take care of it so that way people could come and get fresh produce. It was just a great way for, you know, kids in the community and people to, you know, get to speak with Miss Emma and get whatever they needed. Miss Emma was a big part of the city and she helped fix up a lot of stuff, so it was a great part of the mission trip.
My favorite part was working in a place that was similar to a first harvest? Second harvest, sorry. We packed meals for, was it senior citizens and people that didn't have food. They also delivered like cases of water every day because their water was filled with lead. I think we packed about 750 meals in 4 or 5 hours each day, but that was pretty cool.
All right, so tell us, what were some things that you learned on mission trip that you could apply here in St. Joe, and what would you like to see our youth group go out and do in the future?
For me, there's not, besides like the food pantries and everything like that, there's not too many places where you can go, at least that I know of, and get meals and be able to, like if you need food, to be able to just go get it for free. And how Miss Emma was doing it, and Red and Ashley, just making gardens throughout that little town, and just able to just go pick the vegetables whenever they could. I think it would be awesome to be able to try to start something like that here around the church and stuff like that, and just help out struggling communities.
Following up with what Braden said, I like the idea of starting our own garden. We just tore down the house, so we have a very open green area. So maybe like add some picnic tables and grow a garden for the community would be a great idea, maybe that we could start as a church community, so.
I think it'd be really cool if we could do more things like what we did at the Harbor House. Those people with like disabilities and things like that, they're really excited to see us. And there's people like that all over. You don't have to travel like however many hours we traveled. Was it like 8 or something? Yeah, like 8 hours to do that type of stuff. I'm sure there's all kinds of people here that would just love to just hang out, just talk to people. And it was a really cool experience. And so if we could do something like that closer, that'd be really cool.
So we know on mission trip there's got to be a lot of flex and flowing, right? Tell us about a time when things didn't go as expected And how did you persevere and cope and get through that? Because there were times of disappointment and frustration, but we did it. We made it.
So, if you don't know, on the way back from Chicago, our van started to break down when it didn't break down, I guess, because Firestone said there's nothing wrong with it. But it put a halt to us going to a cabin that we're looking forward to and put us in some random town called Naperville. Don't know where that is. It's a little suburb outside Chicago. But we kind of adapted real quickly. Got put in a nice little hotel. They gave you warm cookies. That's pretty nice. But it was not what we expected at all, because we were expecting to go to this, like, cabin, you know, spend time with each other, and now we're, like, thrown into a whole different, like, situation. Like, the leaders were like, hey, you know, let's make the most out of it. Most of us had our heads down a little bit. But at the end of it, it was a good time. People had fun, you know. Just changed the entire trip for, like, the ending that we expected, but I think it was for the best, so.
For me, it was not something super impactful and, like, almost detrimental like the van. But when we first got to the Harbor House, there was this lady who had came up to us, Marie or Maria, something like that. And she came up, like, when we first walked in there and, like, started shaking everyone's hands and was saying hello and stuff. But it was... for some people, even me, it was a little nerve-wracking just because, like, never had anything like that before. And for her to just come up right away and start shaking our hands and saying hi, it was kind of crazy in a way just how impacted she was just by us stepping foot in there and just being able to come and say hello and stuff. And so that was something that was, like, nerve-wracking at first for a lot of us, but then, like, she kind of eased us right into it, and it was a blessing.
All right, our last question before we share our video. So we're going to go down the line, and everybody's going to share. I know, I'll put you on the spot. But where did you see Christ, or what do you want to say to your church family? Just start with you. Go on down.
I'll answer both questions. Where I saw Christ the most was probably we had, like, a little community event on, like, the third day, I think, something like that. And it was us and the other two youth groups that were there, and Youth Works, they hosted this little community night. And it was just super cool, like, seeing everyone interact with each other. And you can tell that some of those kids probably don't get that a lot. And so... it was just awesome for them to be able to experience that and for us to be able to be there for it as well. And then what I want to say to the youth family is just thank you for the last 4 years, and thank you guys for the last 4 years for helping us out throughout this, and always making it able for us to have fun times and just make it easier for us to go on mission trips. And so just thank you guys for that.
I think where I saw Christ most was when another girl from a different church was getting baptized in Lake Michigan, and we all came together to celebrate her baptism, and it was just a really great moment of everyone together.
I think where I saw Christ most was honestly at the church that all of the groups stayed at, and it was just kind of cool to see. I keep saying that, I'm sorry. It was just kind of cool to see that everyone was there to serve God, and it was just, I liked it. It was pretty fun. Yeah.
Where I saw Christ most was probably the community night as well, because a bunch of people got together, and we were just having fun. You could see that we were all, like, it didn't matter where we were from, we were all together and having a good time.
So mission trip is pretty special because, like, the whole time you're there, you just feel closer to God, and you just have closer friendships, and everyone's there for the same reason, so you just feel really good. But one time in particular, whenever I really saw Christ, was again at the baptism, whenever we were all there and just, like, celebrating her getting baptized, and it was just a very shared moment. But the whole mission trip was definitely really impactful, and you just feel really close to Christ, and you make better relationship with God and everyone around you, and yeah.
I think the most when I saw Christ was through one of the leaders of the community named Jerry. He was an interesting character, but he's been there his entire life. And, like, we went on this, like, talk with him through the city, and you could just tell that Jerry just, like, loved the town he was in, and, like, Christ was working through him to, like, make the Benton Harbor a better place. And, like, yeah, he would tell a lot of jokes, but, like, what he's done for the community so far, like, the, like, impact he has on the council, you can, like, really see that, like, he is what Benton Harbor needs, so.
I think I saw Christ the most through a man named Gene. He was working at the food pantry, and he was just volunteering. He was homeless. He wasn't being paid. He was just there to serve his community and make it easier for people to find food.
I saw Christ the most just through all the people that we've met. Even with very little, they still had really strong faith, and it was just amazing to see how, you know, different lives can impact so many people, but they still have a great relationship with God. And I just want to say thank you to everyone for giving us all these opportunities, and just amazing people that we've met. Thank you.
Miss Emma, she was crazy. She helped the community a lot and always was there. She wrote a book that we read. I think Ben's going to get a book for the church, so that was really cool to read and see how she impacted the community with that. And I want to say thank you for everything over these last 4 years.
And now we have a little slideshow, I say little, but of just our times, and please feel free to ask any of us questions when it's over or afterwards, and be happy to answer.
Troubled sea, yeah. trust you with our lives. You're the peace in our troubled sea. You're the fire before us, constant in the darkness, and you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Every voice. Fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms.
Fire before us.
Fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore.
Sometimes I think, what will people say of me when I'm only just a memory? When I'm home where my soul belongs, was I loved but no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song?
Recklessly abandoned.
let's sing our invitation song together and just inviting the Lord into our lives that we can all host him the way the youth have been doing this last week and just always in our lives. So.
Prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary.
As we go today, I do pray that we are a living sanctuary, and we thank the youth for sharing their testimony with us. And I just want to leave you with this verse from Philippians. It says, "Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others. In your relationship with one another, have the same attitude and mind Christ Jesus had." The mission field is right outside the doors. We all enter it each and every day, and I pray that as we do so, we are doing it as Christ Jesus did. Have a wonderful week, and thank you for being here. Stick around for the vote for those of you that are members, but for those of you that aren't, you are dismissed. Thank you.
If all the members of White Park would please have a seat, we're going to pass the ballots out real quick. Well, I thought, yeah, Melba and Joyce.